My childhood about APJ Abdul Kalam, the one who is known as a missile man of India, the one who is the main person behind our great defense system, what kind of childhood he had. It's very important, imperative for all of us to know, because the kind of childhood APJ Abdul Kalam had, the kind of, you know, upbringing he had, the kind of education he had, the kind of ideologies with which he was brought up by his parents and teachers. It's very important for us to see that, learn that, and also to adapt ourselves to those kinds of situations or things, right? So in the very beginning, we started reading. So we had read out first and second page. So he was born in a middle class Tamil family. Okay, his father, General Abudin, he was not very formally educated. What is formal education? The one who doesn't go to school and any institute for any education, formally. So he was not formally educated, but yes, he was a very, he had that innate judgment. He had that wisdom with which he was able to bring up his children, that Abdul Kalam came up to the level from where it has, he has become an iconic personality to be emulated by all of us. So, and one more thing from this very parentage, which we come to know is, like this Abdul Kalam's family, though they were not very rich, yet these people had enough to feed others. Though they were not rich, yet they shared a big part of their meals with other people. So if the whole family did not eat as much they used to give. So if Abdul Kalam we know as a great person, then we can ascribe that value of his being generous, kind, selfless to his family background. You all must be knowing that Abdul Kalam, the one who was a great scientist, the great statesman, the one who had been the president of India for two times, when he left this world, he had no bank accounts, no properties in his name. What he left behind was the legacy of his achievements, the achievements with which he did not enrich himself, but with the achievements with which he enriched the nation, the world. So that person, you know, the one who was so, the one who lived a grand life, that person left behind only the legacy of his, values. Got it? So this kind of person's life, Abdul Kalam's life, you know, teaches us. It's a perfect example for all of us to follow, to emulate. Okay, money, wealth, or wealth. This is what usually the human being spends his life for. They come side by side. Money comes side by side. Power comes side by side. You get influence. But the main thing is that we must live a life which becomes an example later on. That is what Abdul Kalam did. So he was one of many children, a short boy with rather undistinguished looks, born to tall and handsome parents. We lived in our ancestral house, which was built in the middle of the 19th century. It was a fairly large pakka house made of limestone and brick on the mosque street in Rameshwaram. My austere father used to avoid all inessential comforts and luxuries. However, all necessities were provided for in terms of food, medicine, or clothes. So father did not bother to provide the family or the children the comforts or the luxuries, but yes, he made sure that the family had enough food, medicine, or clothes. In fact, I would say mine was a very secure childhood, both materially and emotionally. So you people might already be knowing that many of the children, you know, they are well off. Materially, no problem. Money and everything is there. But many children lack that emotional security, which is must for the holistic development of a child. And how does the emotional security come? It comes when the parents are there with you, when the family support is with you. What is family support? When the parents give you quality time, when the parents guide you for the right things. Emotional support is not that parents tell you to do wrong things. When you do wrong, then parents pamper you. Yeah, yeah, beta, don't worry, I'm with you. That is not emotional security. Emotional security is when the child knows that in all difficulties, my parents are with me, and the parents, bring up the child upon the right ideologies. When the parents teach their children the values of honesty, truthfulness, hard work, through their own conduct. It's not that the parents would always be, having a luxurious and comfortable life, but they tell their children to go for a very difficult and hard life. Okay, what parents do, children follow them simultaneously. So when parents, don't lecture children, but tell them, but make them do the things which they do, right? The Second World War broke out in 1939 when I was 8 years old. For reasons I've never been able to understand, a sudden demand for tamarind seeds erupted in the market. So the Second World War broke out in 1932. So at the time, Abdul Kalam was only 8 years old. So he was never able to make out, why was there a demand for the tamarind seeds in the market? Tamarind, you understand, Imli. I used to collect the seeds and sell them to provision shop on Mosque Street. So what Abdul Kalam used to do when he was only 8 years old, then he would collect the tamarind seeds from the market and he would give them to a provision shop or to a general shop. Okay, the shop which sends, general things, grocery shop. He would give them to that shop on Mosque Street. A day's collection would fetch me the princely amount of one anna. So in one day, he would be able to get one anna. And that was a very good amount at that time. My brother-in-law, Jalaluddin, would tell me stories about the war, which I would later attempt to trace in the headlines in Deenamani. So his brother-in-law, his name was Jalaluddin, he would tell him the stories of the World War, right? And he would be able to find those stories in the newspapers. The purpose is, the meaning is that he would read newspapers to verify the facts. Later, he would attempt to trace in the headlines of Deenamani. Our area being isolated was completely unaffected by the war. But soon India was forced to join the Allied forces and something like a state of emergency was declared. The first casualty came in the form of the suspension of the train halt at Rameshwaram station. So in the beginning, the very place where Abdul Kalam lived, that remained unaffected. But later on, when in India emergency was declared, then the first sort of, the problem which came up, the train stopping at the Rameshwaram station. Earlier, the train would stop at the station of Rameshwaram. Now, because of the emergency being declared, the train stopping there. Means the train now did not stop. The newspapers now had to be bundled and thrown out from the moving train on the Rameshwaram road between Rameshwaram and Dhanuskodi. Now, because the train would not stop, so the newspaper bundles had to be thrown out from the moving train on the road between Rameshwaram and Dhanuskodi. Got it? That forced my cousin Samsudin, who distributed newspapers in Rameshwaram, to look for a helping hand to catch the bundles, and as if naturally, I filled the slot. So his cousin, what his name was? Samsudin. So his cousin used to do this job of throwing the newspaper from the moving train. So So he wanted somebody who will collect those bundles of newspapers from the road. So of course, Abdul Kalam filled that slot. So Samsudin helped me earn my first wages. Half a century later, means after 50 years, I can still feel the surge of pride in earning my own money for the first time. So when Abdul Kalam was only 8 years old, then he was able to earn the first wages of his life. And how did he get that wages? When he collected those bundles of newspapers from the moving, from that road, which was thrown by his cousin. So he was able to get the wages, and he says that even after 50 years, I remember the pride I felt when I was able to get my first wages. So when you are able to earn your own money, the kind of happiness you get out of that is inexplicable. You cannot express your, happiness, your, ecstasy at your being able to earn money. Got it? So every child is born with some inherited characteristics into a specific socio-economic and emotional environment and trained in certain ways by figures of authority. So each child has, whenever a child is there, he would always have some qualities which his parents have. And those qualities, they might fit well into the socio-economic or emotional environment. I inherited honesty and self-discipline from my father. Today, if we talk about Abdul Kalam, then it would be, it would not be right to say Abdul Kalam being honest and self-disciplined. Abdul Kalam was very honest. He was very self-disciplined. Okay, even if you people have not read about him, even then you might have heard about so many things about him that it is very easy for us to make out that yes, if there had been some honest and self-disciplined man of the caliber like Abdul Kalam, then we feel like saluting him. So he inherited that honesty and self-discipline from his father. From my mother, I inherited faith in goodness and deep kindness, and so did my three brothers and sister. So from father, he inherited the qualities of honesty and self-discipline, and from his mother, he inherited the qualities of kindness and faith in goodness. What is faith in goodness? When you know that if you do good, the good will come back to you. That is a faith in goodness. Okay? So that faith he got from his mother. And he says, not only me, my all siblings, my all brothers and sisters, they learned these values from our parents. I had three close friends in my school. So who were his close friends? Number one, it was Ramananda Sastri. Right? So first of all, it was Ramananda Sastri, then it was Arvindan, and then it was Siva Prakashan. So he had these three friends. All these boys were from orthodox Hindu Brahmin families. As children, none of us ever felt any difference amongst ourselves because of our religious differences and upbringing. So he had three friends, and all of those three friends were Hindus. Not only like simple Hindus, they were from a very orthodox Hindu family. Who is an orthodox family? The one who is, very rigid about religion. Okay? So all Hindus, all Sikhs, and all Muslims, they don't happen to be rigid always. But some people happen to be very rigid as far as their religion is concerned. Okay? And rigidity is very rarely welcomed. Okay, one should have a rational approach. What is rational? Like whatever we think, whatever we do, it should have a logical base. So he says that his friends were from the Orthodox Hindu family, but these friends were always good with each other because they never ever let their religion come in the way. Okay, they never ever thought about their religious differences or the upbringing. In fact, Ramanatha Shastri was the son of Pakshi Lakshman Shastri, the high priest of the Rameshwaram temple. His one friend, Ramanatha Shastri, was the son of the high priest of Rameshwaram temple. Later, he took over the priesthood of the Rameshwaram temple from his father. So his one friend also, he became the priest of Rameshwaram temple even later on. So Arvindan went into the business of arranging transport for visiting pilgrims. And Shivaprakashan became a catering contractor for the Southern Railways. So this is how his friends got settled later on. But what did Abdul Kalam become? That you all know. He became the president of India. But that was quite late. But before that, what he did? He joined the ISRO. From there, he brought in many missiles. That is why if we talk about Abdul Kalam, we talk about him as a missile man of India. If today our defense system is strong, then maximum of the credit would go to Abdul Kalam. Got it? He gave new heights. He gave new, parameters to the to our scientific base of India. During the annual Sri Sita Ram Kalyanam ceremony, our family used to arrange boats with a special platform for carrying idols of Lord from the temple to the marriage site, situated in the middle of the pond called Rama Tirath, which was near our house. So Ram Tirath, children, is one of the most famous pilgrimages in Rameshwaram only. So when Abdul Kalam was a child, then his family used to manage the boats for the pilgrims whenever there will be Sri Sita Ram Kalyanam ceremony. So during this religious ceremony in Rameshwaram, then this Abdul Kalam and his family used to manage the transportation system, you can say, for the pilgrims. Events from the Ramayana and from the life of the prophet were the bedtime stories my mother and grandmother would tell the children in our family. So Abdul Kalam said, like his mother and grandmother used to tell him the stories, to tell them the stories from Ramayana. So often we people talk about so many differences amongst each other without knowing the facts. Okay, so Abdul Kalam, who was a Muslim, their mothers and grandmothers used to tell Abdul Kalam and other siblings the stories from Ramayana. So this is what, this is the beauty of our India, and it is actually so. If India has been able to have a variety of, cultures and religions, then it is because Indians are all beautiful. Okay, the people like Abdul Kalam's family, it's not just one kind of family. Many people, majority of the people are secular like this. But if there are some disputes, they are only because of those, selfish, money-minded politicians. Otherwise, those kinds of differences don't actually exist. So he says his family used to manage the transportation system for the pilgrims, for the Ram Tirath, or his family even used to listen to the bedtime stories based upon Ramayana. One day when I was in the fifth standard at the Rameshwaram Elementary School, a new teacher came to our class. I used to wear a cap which marked me as a Muslim, and I always sat in the front row next to Ramanatha Shastri, who wore the sacred thread. The new teacher could not stomach a Hindu priest's son sitting with a Muslim boy. In accordance with our social ranking, as the new teacher saw it, I was asked to go and sit on the back bench. I felt very sad, and so did Ramanatha Shastri. He looked utterly downcast as I shifted to my seat in the last row. The image of him weeping when I shifted to the last row left a lasting impression on me. So children, here is an incident from where we come to know like how people create differences. Once a teacher came when Abdul Kalam was in fifth standard in the elementary school. Then a new teacher came in the school. When he saw a Muslim boy sitting with Hindu boy, he told Abdul Kalam to go sit at the back of the class. So Abdul Kalam was of course hurt, but at the same time his friend Ramaradha Shastri was also very hurt and he almost cried crying. After school, we went home and told our respective parents about the incident. Lakshman Shastri summoned the teacher and in our presence told the teacher that he should not spread the poison of social inequality and communal intolerance in the minds of innocent children. So children, in the beginning, we read out that Ramaradha Shastri belonged to an orthodox Hindu family. But see, the father, when that Ramaradha Shastri's father came to know about what teacher had done in the class, he called the teacher and gave him the warning that he must not spread communal intolerance or disharmony and should not spread social inequality. And he should not poison the minds of the young children like that. He bluntly asked the teacher to either apologize or quit the school and the island. Not only did the teacher regret his behavior, but the strong sense of conviction Lakshman Shastri conveyed ultimately reformed the young teacher. Okay, so eventually this person, that teacher, was reformed. He never ever repeated the same mistake. So here was one incident from the childhood of Abdul Kalam. When their parents, the parent of his friend's father, tried to sort out the differences the teacher was going to bring in the class. So here comes the role of parents. Okay, this is what kind of parentage is. But now what happens? Sometimes in our society, the moment a teacher tells a student to either improve upon himself or to mend his behavior, sometimes the parents come up to say, "How dare you say to my child something like this?" The point is, emotional security is when your parents see that your child, that their child is growing up in the right atmosphere. That is important. On the whole, the small society of Rameshwaram was very rigid in terms of segregation of different social groups. However, my science teacher, Sivasu Baramaniam Iyer, though an orthodox Brahmin with a very conservative wife, was something of a rebel. He did his best to break social barriers so that people from varying backgrounds could mingle easily. He used to spend hours with me and would say, "Kalam, I want you to develop so that you are on par with the highly educated people of the big cities." So basically, most of the people in Rameshwaram, they were very rigid in terms of the separation of different social groups. But the science teacher, he was not the one. He was a rebellion. He wanted that people of different social or cultural background should mingle with each other. And he told Abdul Kalam that he must be educated to that extent that he should be counted amongst the highly educated people of the big cities. So one day he invited me to his home for a meal. His wife was horrified at the idea of a Muslim boy being invited to dine in her ritually poor kitchen. Ritually pure kitchen. She refused to serve me in her kitchen. Iyer was not perturbed, nor did he get angry with his wife, but instead served me with his own hands and sat down beside me to eat his meal. So got it? So once that very science teacher, Mr. Iyer, he invited Abdul Kalam to his house for dinner. His family was very rigid. It was an orthodox Hindu family. So the wife of that teacher refused to serve Muslim boy in the pure kitchen. And that teacher served Abdul Kalam with his own hands. Right? His wife watched us from behind the kitchen door. I wondered whether she had observed any difference in the way I ate rice, drank water, or cleaned the floor after the meal. So what's the point? Abdul Kalam ate in the same manner. Abdul Kalam cleaned the place after eating, after finishing of his meal. So that everything was same. When I was leaving his house, Subramaniam Iyer invited me to join him for dinner again the next weekend. Observing my hesitation, he told me not to get upset, saying, once you decide to change the system, such problems have to be confronted. When I visited his house again, that person's wife took me inside her kitchen and served me food with her own hands. So when his teacher invited him again to the house next time, though Abdul Kalam never wanted to go there again, but the teacher had intentionally invited him to his house. He wanted his wife to change and he did not lecture her on anything. But second time when Abdul Kalam reached the house for dinner, then his wife, teacher's wife, served Abdul Kalam in the very kitchen. The meaning is that she had transformed. Then the second, so why had that wife, why did the teacher's wife change the second time? Can you tell me? Why did the teacher's wife change the second time? Why did she allow Abdul Kalam to eat in her kitchen? Earlier she didn't want this, but now why did she do this? Who will give the answer? Raise hand. Come on, raise hand if you know the answer. Your answer may not be very correct, doesn't matter, but you can try to give the answer. Yes. Yes, Tanveen.
Ma'am, when his wife saw his husband that he is serving a Muslim boy with no discrimination in his heart, and he is serving him like his boy, then she decided that she would also transform his her thinking and will decide to serve the boy like his husband.
Okay. Yeah, that's okay. But one thing more is there. That is like the when that wife of Mr. Iyer, when she observed that Abdul Kalam was also eating in the same manner, was also like following all the rituals which she and her family used to do, then she realized that there is no difference. Okay, difference is in our attitudes. Okay, otherwise we all follow the same rule. If a Hindu goes to a temple and if a Muslim goes to the mosque and if a Sikh goes to the Gurdwara, the places might be different, but the emotion is same. What's the emotion? Respect to the Almighty. Okay, we fold our hands in front of the Almighty. That is what everybody does. You may go to a temple, you may go to a mosque, you may go to a Gurdwara, but the thing is same. Okay, Hindu, the way a Hindu will eat, the same way Muslim will eat. Where is the difference? So that is what the wife was able to make out. So she understood that these kinds of differences should not be harbored. Okay, so she realized her mistake and she corrected her mistake when Abdul Kalam came to her house second time and she served her with her own hands in her own kitchen. Got it? So the Second World War was over and India's freedom was imminent. Indians will build their own India, declared Gandhi. The whole country was filled with an unprecedented optimism. What is unprecedented? Something which never happened before. So the whole country, the whole India was filled up with the new kind of enthusiasm or optimism. I asked my father for permission to leave Rameshwaram and study at the district headquarters in Ramanathapuram. So then he took the permission from his father that he would like to go to the district headquarters of Ramanathapuram for higher education, right? He told me as if thinking about, Abul, I know you have to go away to grow. Does the seagull not fly across the sun alone and without a nest? So father told Abdul Kalam that I know that you have to go out for your further development. Because unless and until you leave your shell, you cannot grow up. He quoted Khalil Gibran to my hesitant mother, your children are not your children. They are the sons and daughters of life's longing for itself. They come through you, but not from you. You may give them your love, but not your thoughts, for they have their own thoughts. How beautiful. So this was his father. In the very beginning, this man, you know, Abdul Kalam tells us that he was not formally educated. But is this father lacking in any wisdom? See the kinds of things he told his mother. He told his wife that your children might have come through you, but they are not from you. Okay? They are your sons and daughters, but basically they are the children of life, longing for life. So you may give them your love, but not your thoughts. So what parents can do? Parents can only love their children, but parents they should not try to influence their children with their thoughts. It's not right that if I believe in something, I would like my children also to believe in the same thing. So let children have their own ideology. But yes, doesn't mean that if the children are going wayward or distracted, then parents can of course guide them. But that is also there in the story. See how the teacher transformed his wife without lecturing her. So that is what the story was all about. So we have finished it and time is also over. So tomorrow we will be discussing the question answers of this chapter with me. All questions you go through today, don't write any answer yet. Just go through the questions, discuss the, tomorrow we'll be discussing all the answers. Okay, be ready for that. Be ready for class discussion of the questions. And this week on Saturday, your test day, the test will be of the chapter we did in the previous week. Okay, the chapter which we did last week, that will be there in the test this time. Is that clear?